Welcome to the good, the bad, and the sequel with your hosts, Doug and Jamie.
We are back, and this is the movie podcast, where we're talking sequels, and we do it in two parts. The first, an interview with an actor or someone involved that made the film worth watching. The second, a discussion of the sequel, what they got right, what they got wrong, and how it could have been better. I hope you enjoy our last. We had two interviews for this week's movie, which is pretty awesome. We had Aouda, the Maynard Izayashi. He was the translator for Ace in Ace Ventura 2, When Nature Calls. And we had Damon Staniford, who played the Wachati chief. But before we dive into this very, very quick sequel, quick turnaround from the first film, I have to introduce you to my partner in the sequel watching journey, Jamie Riccardi. Jamie, how you doing?
I'm doing great, Doug. How are you doing?
Pretty good, man. This movie really brought me back. And I know I talk about this with a lot of people, and I talked to you about this when we started this podcast. Like, this movie is really huge for me in what this podcast is about. I watch this movie so many friggin' times, more than the first one. Like, I've seen the first one a lot, but this movie, so quotable. So many of these lines, when they came out, I like could say them before he said them.
Yeah, you know, this is one of the, you know, we've talked about, you know, a lot of the sequels don't hold up to the first movie. And this is one of them that I think is better than the first movie. I've seen this movie 1,000 times as well. You know, I was a huge Jim Carrey fan back in the day. And this is like prime Jim Carrey in this movie.
Ace Ventura, pet detective. How are you this afternoon?
Alrighty then.
And I think this movie is great. So this is one of the few times that you'll hear me say that I really enjoyed the movie.
That's good. That's good. We like that. So one thing I have to say about this movie before we get in and talk about all of it is the first one's like a movie. There's so many different other parts to it. The dolphin getting stolen. There's like other scenes. This movie, he's in every scene of the movie. Like, honestly, it's rare that he's not on the screen.
Yeah, you know, I think that's what I enjoy about this movie. It's not so much like the storyline it's like the scenes in this movie are very funny. They're just like one scene. It's nonstop, first of all. Like, he's nonstop through from beginning to end. But it's the scenes. Like, the first one has the whole, you're right, had other characters. Really, he's the main, like, he just nonstop. And I love it. I think it's almost like a sketch. It's almost like him doing a bunch of scenes from In Living Color.
Oh, yeah. And this is probably the only time I'll ever be able to compare this to something, but I compare this to Terror Toons 3 in the sense Joe Castro wanted to show all of his special effects talent back to boom, 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 right after another. This movie is the same. It's like over and over, just, and everything lands. It's so great.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, we'll get into it, but the only thing that I'm going to say that, you know, watching it, I haven't seen it in a while, but I've seen it 1,000 times. I don't remember some of the background scenery being as bad as saw it. I can't wait to dive into this.
Well, the movie was filmed in South Carolina. And online, the only thing you could see is South Carolina. But when I talked to Maynard, who plays Aouda, the translator, he said some of it was filmed in Texas. So sometimes online, because the movie was, you know, 25, 26 years ago, they filmed it. So it might not be 100% accurate, but he said Texas. So
he wasn't really climbing those mountains?
No, he was not.
I thought he was pulling a Tom Cruise and he was doing his own stunts.
God, that's one thing I have to say about this movie. I don't remember if it's as much in the first one. Did the first one have a lot of other references from other movies? Crying Game, right?
Crying Game was one of them at the end. I don't think as many. And, you know, the other thing I would say is the only other thing with this movie is they were definitely a lot of joke repetitions from the first movie.
Oh, easily. Everyone is hit. The greatest hits is played.
Yeah. With that, you know, add that. And I would have liked to have seen a little bit more like originality. But you know what? He improved on the jokes in the second one compared to the first one.
Definitely.
And, you know, if you haven't seen the first one in a long time, you know, the first one's great. When you watch it, it is like overly ridiculous. Like it's like you talk about Jim Carrey's always like overacting. He totally does it in the first one, where I think he kind of tames it a little bit in the second one, but he's still overreacting, you know? So,
yeah. So right off the bat, like I mentioned, the references for other movies, like the parody, first off, Cliffhanger came out, what, a year before, 6 months before? That's such a cool opening scene.
It's a great opening scene, but the one thing I was thinking to myself is, if you're not a Stallone fan, you know, and you're going to watch a Jim Carrey movie, are you going to get that reference?
No way.
And so, like, you know, or like children today, or people that have never seen it today, you know, or, you know, up until like recently, they're totally not going to get that reference. But man, does he nail it? You know, if you know the movie, a cliffhanger, it's like, it's perfect.
I love when the guy with the helicopter, Ace, you got to turn back. It's only one raccoon. And he's like, if I were you, I'd turn around. And he's like, if I were you and you were me, then I'd use your body to get to the top. Nobody could stop me. So here's a question that I have later, but it's good that you mentioned that. What is a target audience? Because you saw this when you were like 18, 19. I was like 10. So who's this a target for?
Yeah, I know. You know, it's tough because, like, you know, my children have seen this movie and they love it. And you know, they're 14 when they first saw it, they had to be like in middle school. Now, you know, they're in high school and college. They still enjoy it. It's tough because they have a lot of references that only adults would get. I mean, cause there's definitely, I didn't realize some of the sexual innuendos that happen in this movie, you know, and I'm sitting there watching with my daughter and my son and, you know, that was a little uncomfortable, but it is so silly that a lot of adults are like, I know my parents can't stand it. Like, you know, like, so there is, it's, you know what it is? I think it's made for like teenagers and adults who are immature.
No, that's a good, I know. It reminds me of like a Pixar movie, as a movie that you watch with your kid, but then in the movie, there's your super adult jokes that the kid still might laugh at, but you get it because like the cliffhanger parody, Charlton Heston impersonations, like a kid might be like, oh, that's a funny voice and not get really
right,
what it is.
Right. Well, you know, Bugs Bunny was the same way, you know,
oh, yeah.
You, could, you know, but again, this is like, is the rating PG-13?
I don't know.
Because I was assuming it was PG, but then there were some questionable scenes that I'm like, all right, maybe.
Oh, PG-13.
It is. Okay. All right. So, yeah. And I think, you know, it's funny. I think if this movie was made today, it probably would have been R.
Yeah, probably.
With the way the rating, again, 80s PG movies would be definitely rated R. You know, like, so.
This yeah.
So I think just because of some of the innuendos, it would have been a tough call, you know, but it was great.
Yeah.
So here's a main question I have. It has nothing really to do with, well, has to do with the movie, but is there such a thing as a pet detective?
I don't know. It's got to be. It's got to be like, what if there is, how low is that? Is that below like a pharmacy security guard?
Well, I think we discussed this even when we did The Mask, or Son of the Mask. Are there dog catchers? Like, so are pet detectives above dog catchers?
Oh, yeah. And I don't know. Are pet detective and dog? God, I think both of them are pretty terrible jobs. Well, but he has fun with it.
You know what? I almost feel like he doesn't have any friends. The animals are his friends.
I know. He doesn't seem like he can connect with people too, because every conversation he has just goes off the rails.
Well, I think, you know, as I said, like, you know, he goes over the top. I also think he gets more immature this one than he does in the first one. So, and I mean, he's definitely that guy that, you know, it's funny. Like, you know, everybody has that one friend that, you know, he's funny, but sometimes he doesn't stop. That's Jim Carrey. Like, you know, if you're hanging out with him, you know, as Ace Ventura, I think, you know, be funny in the beginning. And then after a while, you're like, all right, I can't take it anymore.
Yeah.
You know, that's the personality that he has. I think people realize with him.
Yeah, there's no off button. And I know you're talking about, I don't know if it was before we started recording or during, but the speculation of a third movie, a fourth film. Would it be? Yeah, it'd be a fourth one, right?
Well, I mean, a third one with Jim Carrey. The second, because I mean, you only had the two, and then you had, you know, the one we did, Ace Ventura Jr.
Junior, yeah, with our friend
Jim Carrey
Josh
wasn't
Floyd.
In there. So that, I mean, it's like saying Dumb and Dumber 3 because we did a Dumb and Dumber when Harry.
That's
Lloyd.
True.
You know, so yeah, I would say a third one.
And the fact that they killed him off in Pet Detective Junior. Well, I guess they kind of did, but yeah, I don't know. But no, yeah, we'll talk about Junior later because it kind of, I think, sort of comes up. But yeah, so I love when he feeds the birds climbing up the mountain. Another one, that's like a corny joke when Ace is climbing up and he's like, he starts to like vomit into the birds. Like so many of these jokes, again, over the top, ridiculous.
Well, you know, my daughter's watching me and she goes, Dad, look how fake that bird looks. That was before he started feeding the bird. I think she was assuming the bird was going to be like a normal bird. And then, you know, he did a little motherly love to the bird and puke in his mouth or regurgitated the food.
So then, like we mentioned before, it's cliffhanger. So if you've never seen that, really Love that movie. Great John Lithgow is the bad guy. But so he's climbing across, going to save the raccoon. The harness belt snaps. He can't hold on to the raccoon. And then the raccoon disappears into dies.
You know, that's pretty sad. I got to be honest. And you know what's funny? I think I was more sad when the raccoon died than when the woman died in Cliffhanger. Spoiler alert.
Yeah.
You know, and you know, it's funny that when they show the helicopter, because I know the helicopter was in Cliffhanger, but the helicopter here looked like a toy helicopter, like floating around, like on a string.
I'm sure it did. It probably did not have the sly budget. And most of the budget of this movie, which one thing that Jim Carrey was kind of, it was kind of his own fault, but he got paid a lot for this movie and the budget was not much more. So that's why a little bit of the scenery in the background, a lot of these things are probably done on the budget end.
Well, he was I believe he was the first $20 million actor to get paid $20 million. So was he paid 20 for this movie? Because I know that or 15.
He got 15 for this 15. Movie.
Okay.
20 for Cable Guy.
Okay. So yeah. So, and what was the budget for this movie? 30 or 20? Like it was like he got like three, I think 2/3 of what the budget was or something, you know? Yeah. So yeah. But I mean, you know, honestly, I mean, knowing the type of movie it is, seeing this, you know, the cheesy backdrop, it kind of made what the movie was, you know, it made you laugh kind of thing.
Yeah. The budget for this one was 30. So half of it went to him. So that's a lot.
That is a lot.
And he just was at odds with the director the whole time. So they get the writer to become the director. It was like a big thing. The guy who plays like the main, I don't really give it away, but you know, the guy who works at the British consulate, what's his name? Cadby. So Cadby was filming. He had to go film some other movie at the time. So he flew to England, flew back. And he said in like those 3 days, it all changed. Carrey was fighting the director. We got to think, really think about it. This guy was so busy. He worked on three movies that came out. I didn't know Batman Forever was already filmed before this.
And you know what? He makes that movie. I mean, like, I believe this movie came out with, he had three movies come out in the same year.
That was Dumb and Dumber, The Mask, and the first Ace Ventura.
Yeah. I mean,
was in 94.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, like he definitely was like the biggest guy, you know, back then. So, I mean, I get it. You know what? You know, the final outcome worked. You know, even though there might have been a lot of behind the scenes, if you didn't know that and you didn't read about it, I think, you know, you would never have known because the movie is great.
Yeah. And he's so great. So the next part might have been silly in any other movie, but so what do you do when you kill a raccoon? You join the monastery with all the monks. And God, it's just so crazy.
Well, and you know, they take it very serious. I mean, or they try to. And then I love when he forces the loser out. When he's meditating.
Yeah.
Right,
No. He says, all righty. Yeah. He catches all the greatest hits come out multiple times, but yeah. So Greenwald gets sent there to get Ace. Cause he's like the greatest pet detective in the world. And again,
he's the only pet detective in the world.
Yeah, that is true. So the first movie he's in Miami. Okay. He's living in a shit apartment. He's not making much money because he's trying to find this pigeon the whole movie for his big payday. But in this movie, he is on a mountain looking for a raccoon. So that is something that, how did he get there? Why is he there?
Well, because, I mean, listen, you know, he saved the Miami Dolphins dolphin, you know? So that's a pretty, you know, like you're out there. He was on TV. He was, you know, like, so now he's got to up it up. You know, he's got to up the ante right now. So you don't know. I mean, the raccoon who is the raccoon like for? Or it was just a random raccoon? Like they didn't even talk about it.
No, I think it was kind of random because they said the plane crashed. And then it reminded me of the movie Alive, because when he climbs up, it's just like that empty plane. And I guess all the raccoon was left by itself. But no, I was thinking that when I'm watching, I'm like, man, even if they did like a name drop, like this is the raccoon of, I don't know, Mike Bill Tyson. Gates. Yeah, Mike Tyson.
Yeah.
Somebody just random. But so he's in the monastery. Greenwald goes up there because they need the greatest pet detective in the world and they need to find an animal.
So the only person they can send there is a fat guy who's walking with a cane up a flight of stairs that has How many stairs would you say were there? Like, how many flights?
Like, probably it must have been like 3,000 steps at least. Okay. And he's sweating going up. Okay. But later when he's going down, he seems very at ease. I know it's going easier to go down, but dude, when he convinces Ace to get out there, cause he's getting paid 20,000. Like, that was a big deal.
Well, yeah.
he was like, man, this is a big check. I guess I'll do it. And I love he's so annoying to all the monks there. What do you call the main monk? What is he?
You know what? You're asking me what they call
him? Master monk? No, but what was in it? He said what he was, maybe master. And he's like, but I never got my crown. Oh, yeah. Here, take mine. But this took you 80 years. No, it's okay. I'll get a new one.
I wrote that. He hated him. He goes, the medal took him 80 years to achieve. And then, like, you know, and then, like, you know, yeah, they couldn't wait to get rid of him because he was annoying. And then, you know, he, I guess they persuaded him to go because it was $20,000. He thought they'd be sad. They're all like excited that he's leaving. And then there's one monk running around in his underwear. Yeah. Like, what was that about? Like, I didn't understand that. Like, they're all dressed in monk gear and you have this one fat guy who's running around in his underwear.
And how does that conversation come up? Does the director or, well, the director was the writer. He's like, all right, I know we got 40 monk extras. Hey, number 37, take your pants off. It's like, what? I don't want to do that. You want to be a featured? And then Ace is going to point at your butt and then say, they don't usually act like this. But the slinky part, God, how many times I quoted this as a kid with the slinky, like going downstairs and then the same thing. Oh, so close. Can I do it again?
I remember when I first saw that for the first time, I was dying because just the way he screams at the, I'm like, you know, he was so upset and then you wanted to do it again. He has to. Yeah. Have you ever done that with a slinky on a stairs?
Yeah.
I don't think it ever makes it down for me. Like, I don't know if I have the right form or not, but I always had trouble.
I never got all the way down, probably big flights of stairs, but there's a way you could cheat if you do it towards the end. But no, I guess I have to get a slinky and do it.
I mean, towards the end, like on the last step?
Yeah, no, towards the end of the step. So, he has pretty good momentum.
Gotcha.
But now that slinky, man, if you're just giving a kid a slinky right now for a gift, they'd probably kill you.
How boring, think about it, how boring is a slinky? Like, really, like, even back in the day when you had one, like, everybody wanted one, but like, you really, I think it was one of those toys where you get it for like maybe 10 minutes and then you never use it again.
Yeah.
It's fun for the first 10 minutes and that's it.
Well, there's a lot of toys like that. Like, I know the yo-yo, you can do tricks. So it'd be like yo-yo, slinky, pet rock.
Well, I think, oh, yeah, yo-yo, you can do tricks when you're like, you know, like most people, I don't think I've ever really seen anyone do a trick. You know, maybe except the cats in a cradle, the simple one that everybody does. Outside of that, knowing that it's like, again, those are the toys that are really boring. Even silly putty. You know, it's fun putting on the comics for 2 seconds and then, all right, now what?
Yeah, I know. But back in the day, that's all you could do. There's no like other thing to do.
I guess.
So now Ace, he's on the plane. He's going there. Then he finds out it's a bat.
Well, is this before he started making the animal noises?
Yeah, no, that was right around the same time. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. So he finds out the bat and that's one question I had, like, cause he is the lover of all animals.
Yeah.
That, like, why would he not like the bat? I mean, listen, I hate bats, and the way he reacts throughout the whole movie is pretty much the way I would react to a bat, a mouse, a rat, like, you know, like I'm the same way. Like, you know, but he's a lover of all animals. So I'm surprised that there is an animal that he doesn't like.
Yeah, and that's one thing that Jim Carrey hated about the script.
Oh, he wanted
hated
to like
that.
Okay.
Well, not even think he wanted to write. He just thought it was a dumb storyline, like at the time. But yeah, the bat that they have in the cage, I don't think it's real. It's probably a puppet. Yeah. But the teeth on that thing is
the just red eyes. Well, you know, but honestly, it works. I mean, I think the fact that he doesn't like it and the way he's running with it and the way he's always speaking, I think it's hysterical. So I think it does work. So I guess the writers knew what they're talking about.
Yeah.
You know, and then back on the plane, when imagine sitting next to somebody being annoying like that, making all these different animal noises that he was doing. Because
fake was that airplane looking? Oh. It looks so small.
I said the same thing to my kids. I said, it looks like this, first of all, like there's like only like four rows in the whole air, but they make it look like it's such a huge plane.
Yeah. Yak. You want to hear the sound of the yak? Yak.
So I didn't know that a yak's noise is just basically saying yak.
Peanuts? Do you want peanuts? Peanuts. I have one right here. And he points to his dick.
He goes, yeah, I usually, what do you say? It's bulky or I yeah, usually it's carry on or something or.
Yeah, it's bulky, but I usually bring it as a carry.
Oh, consider a carry on. Yeah. And you know, that was the beginning of myself as I'm watching it with my kids. I'm like, you know what? I forgot. There's a few of these that they're going to be coming up.
And these are the, like you talked about, these are a lot of the greatest hits from the first one. First one, sunflower seeds. Smoking, it's a disgusting habit. He's spitting on the table. This one, Greenwald sleeping, and he spits all the peanut shells all over his arm.
And he does eat like a hamster or a chipmunk.
Oh, I know.
And I think he did that in the first one too.
Yeah. So how about when they're supposed to be in Nibia? Why the hell is there a random Subway ad on a billboard in English?
Well, I mean, the budget was what, $30 million, and you know they had to make some extra money. You know,
oh, so I know I figured, they did, but couldn't they have at least put it in like Nibian or whatever the language is? Like, I don't know.
What's the language in Nibia?
Click clock. I don't know. But it should be something like that. But so here, we're this far into the movie. We already have cliffhanger, Twilight Zone reference. There's something on the wing.
Yep.
So I know kids will laugh at it, but even at that age, I watched a lot of older things. So I saw a cliffhanger. Like back then, there was nothing. But yeah. I feel like nowadays it'd be so lost. Even like Chitty Chitty Bang Bang reference.
Well, the songs in the movie. Yeah, I mean, I didn't understand that. Like the singing Chitty Chitty Chitty. That was just so random and weird. You know, like I didn't get that. But yeah, the Captain Kirk impression. I forgot that he was in Twilight Zone. You know.
Yeah.
I think he's the one that does that one with the plane, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's in two of them. He's in that one, and he's in the one with the when they're at the diner, and the alien is saying humans on the menu. That's a good one. That's a good Twilight Zone.
Oh, okay.
No, but it's so funny that this movie seems like it's a lot of that. And it would be fun to look at the script and see if a lot of these things are original bits. Because I could see Jim Carrey just be like, all right, I can do a great Captain Kirk. I use that in my SNL audition. I'll throw that in there. I can do this, that, because there's so many of those.
Without a doubt, I would say that, especially since he had such power in this movie, that he did so much ad-libbing in this whole movie, you know, and like Chitty Chitty Bang Bang, he probably sang a bunch of different songs and they probably like, you know what, that's the one that's gonna, you know, fit. Because he without a doubt was doing all this improv.
I love when he shows up at the consulate and you're like that buddy that you can't bring places. How about he thinks in his mind it's a good way, he's slamming his hand onto people's food while they're eating, and then he puts the cherries in his nose and the asparagus in his teeth.
Yeah,
that's so great.
I would say his immaturity definitely came out. Like, this is a guy you definitely don't want to bring up. Like, you have those friends that, you know, like, again, they're funny, but when you don't want other people to see him the way he's acting, you know, like, how annoying. I mean, his immaturity at that whole very conservative party was just ridiculous.
Yeah, and that Monopoly guy scene, quote that. That's one thing I always quote.
That's one of my favorite scenes. I mean, first of all, how big is that guy? He's tiny.
He's tiny, and his... Dude, his wife is, she was smoking. I'm like, I don't remember as a kid that he looks so old, the Monopoly guy. He looks like a young guy that just they put gray in his eyebrows and like a bald cap on. But I'm like, damn, dude, how the hell did this guy get it?
I don't know if his wife is smoking.
She was pretty attractive.
Well, yeah. I mean, you know, compared
to
him.
For that guy to land him?
It's a home run for that guy.
But he's probably the Monopoly guy. So that's why he has all that money.
Well, that's exactly what it is.
And he does, you know, them for the free parking.
when he's walking around and acting French, and he's like, you know, when he's like rubbing the guy's leg, and I that was one of my favorite scenes, you know. And I remember watching that when I was younger too. That was just great.
Do not pass go. Do not collect $200. Rah rah rah. And he's just shaking his like lifeless mouth.
You know, and we skipped over this. How about when he was driving the Jeep to get there? and first of all, it looked like it was going like 20 miles an hour, but he's like bouncing all over the place, like is on the rough terrain. And then this seems to be a habit when he drives, like, I guess he doesn't know how to park. Is that what it is? Or he doesn't know how to slow down?
In the first one, he just had the crack windshield and he had to look outside the window. This movie is like tumbling a car and getting out unscathed, just walks right out of the car.
But it's just ridiculous. Like, it's almost like they find a one joke and then it's got to keep writing it. And that's because it happens, I think, twice in the movie. He flips around multiple times.
Yeah, one time he lands upside down. And it's fine. And he has to throw in a, like a glove. So it's we're probably 20 minutes in. There's so many first movie jokes that, again, are in this one. Some are better, some are the same. And then we already get in the jungle when they show the gorillas having sex. Just randomly.
Well, it was a foreshadowing moment.
It was foreshadowing. It was, yes.
Okay, so he had that weird walk in this movie, kind of like a Conor McGregor, like, right? Did he have that same walk in the first movie? I don't remember, like, being this
pronounced. Yeah, it's not, it wasn't as bad in the first one, but he did have sort of like a strut to him.
Yeah, yeah, but it reminded me of like a Conor McGregor kind of. Yeah. So, yeah, okay, so he's at the consulate, right? And this is when he meets the guy. Who's the guy that he first meets? It's the guy with the mustache, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so
Cadby, yeah.
Right. So when he's whipping the horse, yeah. Right? And then Jim Carrey takes it out of his hand. Reminds me of Dumb and Dumber scene. You know, he takes the whip and he whips the guy. And he's, what do you say? He goes, it's funny. It didn't seem that painful. When you were when you were doing it to the horse.
Yeah, that is a great scene. So I love when he gets to the village is the probably the bumblebee tuna is the best. When he gets there, all the guys are saying, bubble way a tuna. And he just keeps saying, bubblebee tuna. He's like, excuse me, your balls are showing. bubblebee tuna.
Well, before that, you missed the whole shadow puppet.
Oh, yeah.
So it's, again, this movie, he just goes from one shtick to the next, you know. But yeah, I thought that whole shadow scene was pretty funny.
For the kids, who doesn't love a good Zorro joke, right? Oh, no, that wasn't.
It was the Lone Ranger. Right. That's, and you know what? Like, even then, like, I couldn't think of who it was. I'm like, I was going to my kids, who was with Tonto? Because I remember Tonto, I couldn't remember the Lone Ranger. So, right, another reference that I think only certain people are going to get.
Oh, yeah.
But they were laughing.
Rubbing the nipples and yeah.
Well, that's the funny part. Or when the snake's biting his crotch and it's spitting.
No, he's just on fire. That's why there's like so many times, so many lines I couldn't write down because there were just so many right after another. But and then they have the random thing in a village. I don't know why a tribe would want to. This is the way to like grow, get higher up a level in the tribe is standing on top of a totem pole. Just dude, when he shit earthquake tests. He starts shooting, and then later he's shooting with spitballs. It's just like, what?
Yeah, well, you know, it's almost like Survivor. I mean, like, you know, they have to do these things on Survivor where the balance and listen, you want to be a real warrior in the Watuchi tribe or whatever. What is it? Watuchi?
It's Wachat. It is Wachati.
Oh,
the good Wachati. One. The other one's the Wachutu.
Ah,
Wachutu. Why the hell do they have to do that? Why couldn't they at least have different letters?
Yeah. Or at least, you know, just, you know, different names. I mean, like, yeah, that's ridiculous. But yeah, and then he goes to the guard. I love, he goes, did the guard see anything? Or what was
the baboon? That was cool seeing a baboon like that close and just standing there. I was like,
yeah.
I think it was probably so doped up on drugs or something, which is sad. But I love that scene. And I got some behind the scenes from when I talked to Damon Staniford. Who played the Wachati chief when they're in there and they're going back and forth and they're hawking the loogies on each other. So when they came out of there, he tells a funny story about it, but they basically covered their faces. They used KY jelly.
No.
Yeah. And they really did. When they showed the spit, that was a real spit.
I'm sure.
Jim Carrey said to spit on me.
Oh. So was that Jim Carrey spit when he spit out?
No, that was KY jelly. But now the story that he told me, some kid, he was at some party at his friend's house, and the kid goes to Damon and says, man, that's the funniest scene in the movie. What'd you guys do? And he's like, not even thinking. I'm like, yeah, we use KY jelly. And then the parent came over. He's like, you can't say KY jelly to a 12-year-old.
You know what's funny? As I'm watching that, I was waiting for like a kind of a blooper of like their faces being clean. But the whole time they're talking out of there, it's still dripping off their face.
Oh, I know.
So that was awesome.
And then another joke that's so funny is the Chicago, Chicago. Like, dude, there's just so many after and after. Like you said, they take the ones from the first one and they just have so many new ones that are amazing.
Well, they also said that, you know, they have not seen disease until the white man came and then Jim Carrey sneezes. or even like when Jim Carrey starts, I mean, I think it was a little before, but when he started describing the bat when they were standing by the cave and like, just again, you know, I put myself in, because I mean, there's some people that, you know, don't cringe with bats or snakes or rats. I'm okay with snakes, but bats look like mice and I can't stand like skeeve mice. And when he's describing the bat, I would be the same way. The way he acts, it's like just so icky. Like it's very funny the way he does it.
So you're okay with snakes? So when you saw Indiana Jones, you're like, shut up, Jones. It's just snakes.
Yeah. You know, it's just, they don't look as creepy.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know. Bat, especially this bat. I mean, this bat had, I think, beady red eyes.
Yeah.
Fangs and red teeth and like, and all white. First of all, I've never seen a white bat before. I don't even, are they like real bats that are white?
I'm sure there's albino of most animals maybe, but so you're telling me you'd rather be toe to toe with the 60-foot anaconda than?
Are they considered a snake?
I would hope so.
Huh.
It's not steroids.
Well, maybe. Well, I'm sure. if I'm with David Hasselhoff, then I'm okay. And you said you think most animals have an albino animal? Well, like a zebra would have an albino?
Well, humans, there's albino humans.
So you're comparing a zebra to a human?
No, but I'm sure there's albino or some different looking zebras.
Well, if there's an albino zebra, wouldn't that be like a white horse?
Or
yeah, yes. So you're saying a white horse might be an albino zebra?
It could be.
Okay.
If anyone listening has any leads or if you are like a, what, I don't know.
A zebra wrangler?
Zebra wrangler, zoologist, zookeeper, just give us a call. So one reference I never got as a kid, because, you know, when we watch these movies and you're taking notes, you get a really deep dive. But when he had the jalapenos on his fingers, he did like a Freddy Krueger voice. He was like, hey. He like did like this weird like Freddy Krueger, and he did the jalapenos like in the guy's face like it was like the finger knives. And I'm like, that's pretty cool.
You know what? I went past me. I mean, I just thought he was just being a jackass.
And he sees the princess and he is... real dude, and she's like right in front of his face, he's just he almost lost it.
Well, when he's just sitting there and he's like describing how he took a life of celibacy, or you were just talking about like how he doesn't judge the body, and all of a sudden all you see is the princess's stomach, like nose, like his nose is like belly button, like height,
yeah,
and he loses it, like then you know, and then the next scene is great,
but he keeps it good because he goes,
well,
let them dance, and then he goes to finger dust.
But does, well, no, the next scene, isn't the next scene when he was?
No, the next scene right after that, she asks Greenwald to dance, and Uta comes up to dance.
Oh, okay,
because he watches them, and he sneaks away, and this is when he uses a lot of finger dust, and nothing's there at all.
Well, you know, I was looking around, he had looked like he was wearing more on his whole body than he had around. I mean, he had it all over the place, but like he was covered head to toe.
Yeah. And let's talk about the way he looked and the way everything in that room, because it reminded me of towards the end of the movie, the fight scene between him and Tommy Davidson, which we'll talk about more in depth later. But why was everything white? It looked like it snowed.
Yeah,
the ground was all snowy. Like maybe there was snow in South Carolina or Texas when they filmed. They were just covered in like a powder.
Yeah.
Weird.
Well, I mean, but their makeups were all powder too. So,
yeah, but the ground was the same color as their makeup.
Well, maybe they're trying to blend in.
Well, maybe. Maybe they're hiding.
There you go.
There was, see, a war that was going to happen, maybe.
See? See? It's like using, you know, camouflage. That's their camouflage.
Yeah.
So he does the dusting, and then his keen senses knows to look underneath the cage.
Smart guy.
Well, he is a pet detective.
Yeah.
And he found the feather. Now, at that point, though, he's not putting two to two together, right?
I don't think so, because I don't think he saw that guy yet, did he? He only saw a photo of that guy during the slideshow.
You mean the guy from Shawshank?
Yeah, Burton Quinn, yeah.
Yeah.
So he didn't see Quinn yet. So I think he saw photos, but didn't think about the Raven until he sees him later. I think in the next scene, he pretty much sees him. But how about when Ace hangs out with the princess? We talked about it before when he was shooting the spitballs and he teaches her how to do it. And then they seem like they're about to do something. And he restrains himself, right?
Well, so I had a question about this.
Okay, good.
Okay, so he restrains himself, but we find out later on he doesn't restrain himself.
Yeah, but that's, I don't know. Maybe there was another part they did it.
Because
where was she? Because it almost looked like Greenwald walked into him jerking off.
Oh, he did.
Oh, it was just jerking off. Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, she was the way he covered.
No. Because he had like the jelly next to him, like Vaseline next to him, the bottle of Vaseline. He it was almost like a Tommy Boy. Wasn't that happening at Tommy Boy? He came in. That's why he put the pillow over himself. And then, yes, he was. And that's why he was also breathing heavy. Like, you know, he's nervous. But that's my question, because she wasn't there for that. Obviously, he was alone. Because don't forget, like, she took her top off in front of him.
That's what it was. Yeah.
And then she put it back on. Right. So, like, because he kind of rejected her because he took a life of celibacy. And then he regretted that decision, obviously. And that's when he got caught. But we find out later that he was with her.
Yeah. So when I was thinking maybe after he gets shot with the darts, like she took advantage, but he knew that he remembered it. So it wasn't then, because he knew. He goes, they can tell that.
So you know what? Maybe there was a they can tell that. Maybe there's a deleted scene or something, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know.
Where is that?
Yeah. Because I mean, that those two things did not, because I don't think there was actually any time for him to do anything. If you didn't do it then, there was no time to do it any other time.
Yeah, that is weird. So one thing about this movie, there's a lot of montages from like here on. There's like a lot of good, they're all funny, but the montage with Secret Agent Man, that's so great, man. I know they're superimposed. He's not obviously with the lions, but they're just so funny, like the ad-libs that he probably did at those points.
Well, you know, that cracked me up, because he said I'm a master of disguise, first of all, right? He said that. He didn't wear one disguise except for the rhino. So like, you know, like he's with the lions eating the carcass, but he's dressed as himself. He was hanging out with the monkeys, just picking, but dresses himself. And he was with the hippos in the water, dresses himself, although his ears wiggled. So
he did wiggle. He looked like alfalfa.
He did. But so is that a master of disguise if you're not really wearing a disguise? He just blends in like his.
I would say he's a master of blending in.
Now, how stupid are people around that they can't notice a human hanging out with all the animals?
Yeah, no, I know. Nobody notices it at all. And here's something we got to talk about. We talked about how much he got paid, which was $20,000 to do this. Where the hell did he get a mechanical rhino? And how much was it?
That thing was very high tech. Yeah. I mean, very high tech. Although I would say the controls are a little off. I mean, to be able to move the rhino, you got to pull levers back and forth. I mean, you know, I would expect it to be a little better, but yeah, like where did he get that? Because he wasn't expecting to use the rhino, like, you know, like this whole situation. So that was a little interesting, but that scene was amazing.
Yeah, no, I always love that. Like he taps, the fan goes, he taps, it goes a little bit, dies, like sputters out, and then he can't open the door and you're like, oh shit. And then dude, this is one of the funniest. When he comes out of the butthole, the rhino, and just the whole like the finger going in, you don't write that. It's Jim just saying, here's what I'm going to do. And you only get one shot at it, or they have to rebuild it because he would have ripped it.
Right. Well, also, how small is that hole that his whole body fit through? I mean, the whole is so ridiculous. His face like pushing at it like that. Without a doubt, I agree with you. That was all improv. I mean, but how do you fit through that hole?
That's the miracle of life, Jamie.
Oh, that's how. That's how rhinos give birth, right? Yeah. Through their ass. All right.
How about those kids, that family that stumbled upon that? So they're in therapy right now, right? Or after
therapy, but like I've never been on a safari. Would they allow them to get out of the Jeep?
I would hope not. And then the worst is when they get back on, they're not in like, usually they're in, you hear the stories on the news all the time. They're like, woman gets eaten by a lion. And even in those, they're encaged. Like in the back of a truck,
right?
It's encaged.
Yeah.
This man, not enclosed at all, wide open for not a lion. Enclosed,
wide open, and you're like very close. So if a rhino's giving birth, you know the daddy rhino's probably nearby. Like you want to be that close to that, you know, like yeah. And you know, they're just standing there, whole family posing like, you know, like it's nothing. You're in the middle of safari, you know.
Maybe they knew that it wasn't real because the rhino doctor wasn't there.
So the rhino didn't have a midwife, so it was like, all right, you know.
The rhino dad was with his buddies. They were having a beer and cigars in the waiting room.
Well, she was alone, so maybe the daddy left her.
Oh, man, dude. teen rhino. Oh, my God, dude. I'm really goofy today. But so the next part, so he captures Cadby and he has him in a dark room, the lights flickering, almost reminds you of I'm trying to think. Did that spoof anything? Because it kind of reminded me of a different movie, but
you know, it was any
generic,
like, yeah, any yeah. generic torture movie. I mean, you know, the what was the first one? It was what was the first torture? Because the second one was the eyeball. What was the first one?
The first thing he does? Oh, yeah. What was it? It wasn't like a paper cut, was it?
Oh, no. He was scraping the knife.
Oh, scraping the knife, yeah.
Which is, you know, let me tell you something. If you're going to torture someone, that's pretty good.
Oh, yeah.
That's like, that's annoying. But that guy stood stuff tough. And then the eyeball thing was pretty gross. I've never seen anyone do that. Have you?
Oh, no. And then he's like, my brother used to do that. And he's
like, so I mean, like, I was questioning. I go, dude, is that something like big brothers do to their little brothers? Like, they push their eyeball?
I was thinking in my head, I'm like, is that like a good torture technique? Like waterboarding? Then if they don't say anything for the waterboarding, do the eye push ball. Like, cause when he's pushing the eyeball and it's like, ooh, I'm like, dude, that's gross.
And he did his own stunts. He did it.
Yes, he did.
Jim Carrey did it. So
I wonder, he better.
Who's the first person to do that? So, you know what? I'm going to see how far I can push my eyeball and like, you know, like move it back and forth. How gross is that?
I bet you that guy has one eye now.
Who, Jim Carrey?
No, the guy who ever pushed it too far. He was like, I can do this. And he's like, And then the next part's really funny too, because why the hell would Ace, after doing this, he's like, he finds out that he has nothing to do with it. He was trying to get the bat, but he didn't steal the bat. And then he says, oh, well, I'm going to untie you, but don't do anything to me, okay? I'm sorry. And then why the hell would Ace get into a car with him? And who threw him off? Because he gets thrown off. The other guy's driving. So who throws him?
Yeah, you know what? It almost looks like he jumped off.
He did. Oh, definitely. Him and the monkey are just like laying there.
Now, yeah, did the monkey get thrown off too?
Yeah.
Oh. Yeah. So they had someone throwing Ace off and the monkey.
Yeah.
Now, the monkey was in the first movie too, right?
That's the same monkey. That is the monkey that, you know, our close personal friend of the podcast that we're helping out, Larry Henkin. That's the same monkey from Friends. The same monkey that's in Dr. Doolittle.
Oh, it is the same monkey for Friends. Yeah, Marcel. Oh, wow. Interesting.
Yeah.
So that monkey gets royalty checks when
I don't know. I think he gets paid in bananas. Oh, man. 1,000 bananas today. I guess Ace played a lot. But no, he's great in this. And the next part is probably, there's so many great parts of the movie, but the dart. God.
So this is, to me, this scene is typical. If you're a fan of like In Living Color, they use Jim's flexibility a lot in that show. And the way he's running with his arms flapping around because all these darts that are going into him was amazing. Like, this is Jim Carrey at his best.
When he's when he's like, after he gets shot and he's running and he's just like flailing his arms back and forth, I think I lost him. And then it's like four or five darts in the back and he just,
no, that was awesome. Now, was the monkey with him at this time when he's running?
Yeah, but this monkey, we learn later, this monkey is not about Jim. Does not care about Ace.
He does not.
I wouldn't trust him. Maybe that would have been a good twist. The monkey was in on it.
Maybe he was.
But so how about when Ace gets, you know, he wakes up and we see the princess, like, basically, like, caring for him. And Ace is talking about a Mr. Beauregard. Now, is that a movie spoof? And he's doing a Southern voice.
No, yes, he said Scarlet. He's doing Gone with the Wind.
Oh, I thought it was like a repressed memory that he said.
No. He's doing, he was sounding like Scarlet, either the maid or, what's her name? O'Hara, whatever her name was. But they were doing, I'm almost positive they were doing
another classic reference a teenager would get.
Not at all. Yeah. I do declare, right? Yes. Scarlet, something like that. I think I want to say it was Gone with the Wind.
Yeah. So then after that, we find out from there that it wasn't, because so what happened right after that? He just woke up and that was it?
He woke up in the princess, you know, I guess he was surrounded by the guy with the cane and the princess, right?
Yeah.
Maybe that's when she took advantage of him.
Maybe.
But then he realized that the dart that shot him, oh no, was it the dart that shot him that wasn't the same one? No, that's later.
But I feel like right now is when he says he has to go.
Well, he had to go to the other tribe. But what made him go to the other tribe?
I don't know. I forgot. But he goes to the Wachutu tribe. But these guys scare me. The other ones seem nice. Bumblebee Tuna, they're saying hi to everyone. This one, they have a lot of human skulls. There are so many human skulls on everything. Like we talked about a little bit before. They're covered in white. They're just scary looking. And how about that? So do you think they really use the mask, like a prototype from the mask? Because that mask is the same one, just with all the other garb on top of it.
Yeah, you know, it definitely looked like. I mean, when did a mask come out? That was before this one,
before,
right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I bet you did. I mean, you know.
It looked too much like it.
The budget was only $15 million. So, I mean, you know.
Hey, they had Ace, hey Jim, we're really tight on the budget. Do you still have that mask from the movie that you kept? Can we use it? Sure, man. Whatever I can do to help. But no, that scene is so great. He grabs the mask. He's dancing, jumps over the fire, and then just takes the mask off. And then all the spears just all around him. Right.
Well, he got so into it.
Yeah.
Like he got so into the dancing that, you know, he just, you know, yeah, he just took his mask off and it was almost like he was waiting for an applause, like for his moving. And then this, when gingivitis came over.
Yeah. Well, the translator, the best is the translator just before. He's really funny. This is like when Maynard, his scenes are great with Ace.
He's completely useless. I mean, like, I mean, he does a great job acting in a movie, but like, as like Jim Carrey's only friend, I guess, like, you know, Sean, he really is useless. Yeah. Like, he's like, oh, and you can see Jim Carrey just keeps getting annoyed at him.
Don't beat yourself up. Ace, I'm here. They didn't just capture you. They captured me too.
And he's like smiling. Like, you know, he had an innocence about him. You know, like, you know, yeah.
That white devil, like that is like classic.
So what was his purpose of not translating the right way? Like, you know, like, because Jim Carrey was trying to, like, you know, like explain what he's doing and why he's doing it. And the translator was just basically digging him deeper and deeper.
Yeah. I don't know if it was maybe his English wasn't as good, like Maynard's English, him like translating it back. But I know that I love scenes like that in movies when people are translating. Oh, yeah. It's like totally wrong, but no, that made no sense. But maybe his English wasn't as good as like we thought, but the white devil. And he's like, did you say white devil? And he's like, well, that's how they know you. Take that part out.
And then you get the montage.
This
montage is great. And he has to do, I guess, pass all these tests and then they'll let him live.
Yeah.
Right. And the first one was the coal.
Yes.
You know, they actually do that. There's, you know, Tony Robbins,
I think. Yeah.
So he does, you know, a thing with hot coal that, like, you know, you pay for like a weekend of motivation from him. And then at the last day you walk on coal.
That's good. Like you pay to hurt your feet.
Well, the whole point is you're using your mind and you don't feel the pain. So, yeah. But Jim Carrey outsmarts them and knocks the guy down and just steps all over. And not only that, it looked like he stepped a little longer at his face and like dug his face into the coal.
You would think they would hate this guy. And like after that, they're like, they seem very violent. So right after that, they probably would want to kill him. And then when he's on the log, when they're doing like the log, which I don't know what the hell they were doing, because they're both just standing there. He takes off his pants. Another one. Okay, we have 30 extras for the Wachutu. All right, who wants to get an extra $100 in your paycheck? All right, stand on this log. Jim Carrey's going to take your pants off. You're going to be naked. He's going to hit you in the ass. You're going to fall in the water.
So these guys are warriors, and all they have is a little loincloth with no underwear or anything underneath there?
No.
They had no underwear on, so he just had a loincloth.
Yeah, I guess maybe Haynes hasn't infiltrated Nibia yet.
All right, but I mean, I can't imagine really like fighting a, like, just either an animal or a person in just a loincloth. I would think like I'd be like bouncing around and like it'd be a little uncomfortable.
I would get nervous if it would catch on something.
That too.
On a tree. Ugh. Dude, like, sticker bushes. I don't know if they have sticker bushes there, but
imagine running without wearing like, you know, underwear or something. Like, that's gotta be uncomfortable.
It would hurt.
Yeah.
Could be loud.
Yeah.
But no, that one's good. And then I loved when the witch doctor that you talked about a little bit with the gingivitis, when he rips the still beat heart, Indiana Jones Temple of Doom asks.
Correct.
And then Ace goes, I'm going to do you one better. He shoves his hand down a guy's throat. And then when they do the cutaway.
Not only his hand, up to his elbow, his arm.
Smacking his elbow. He's like jamming it. To pull out an apple core. Not even an organ. And that was passing. No, I think he passed when he pushed on the woman's belly and the baby flew out. Dad caught it, and he's like, la, 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 la.
And he had the umbilical cord still attached, so they were very realistic. But how does one swallow an apple core?
Lots of practice. I don't know. Okay. But no, how about if the dad was sitting like maybe a few feet back, the umbilical cord would have stopped the baby? Could have been bad. Good thing that the dad was sitting close enough.
Do you think like it would have been like a bungee and like it would have snapped back?
It would have just went right back in and he'd have to do it again. Boom. All right. So now we have nice In Living Color alums going at it. Tommy Davidson, man. I wrote this down. He never got a big role in a movie.
He played a side character a few times.
He could be a great like a real sidekick, like featured in most in like the whole movie, you know?
He could. I mean, but I don't know if he could star in his own, but like,
not about starring, but yeah. Right.
But he's totally like, he even in Living Color, he was that great like side guy in every sketch. And he makes the scene. I mean, first of all, he looks like he weighs about 65 pounds.
Yeah.
No, he's a small little guy. Just even before he comes out there, when Ace sees the big, first of all, everybody moves aside. You see this big giant of a man come walking out for the last test. And Jim Carrey's looking at him. And he's like, all right, you can see like he's kind of crapping his pants. Like, this guy's a monster. Yeah. And he turns around and he sees little Tommy Davidson tucked in a, like a knapsack. And Jim Carrey starts laughing. Like, almost like, this is who you want me to be. like he was like, and meanwhile, everybody, like even the big guy, when he untied the knapsack, he kind of did like as far away as he could and ran away. Like you don't know what to expect from this little Tommy Davidson, you know, who's like a cage animal.
Dude, he's insane. The fight scene, Ace just gets his ass kicked the whole time. The montage, using his head like bongos, grabbing him by the top of like his mouth, pulling him by his teeth. It's pretty intense. And then the end of it, it makes no sense. He didn't pass the challenge.
Well, I think they were laughing so much they felt bad for him because they said you act like a real sissy boy, and they started laughing, so they felt bad. They're like, you know what? Let's just give it to him.
Because I love that he's like a kid in school. He's looking away. They're all grouped together, and Uda's talking to them, and he's like, "You're okay with them, but they will kill you if you don't have the bad return." But he's looking the opposite direction, like a kid that was in trouble.
He was mad, and you know, again. The translator did not help him much. You know, I mean, think about the knowing a fight when Tommy Davidson threw a spear in his leg, you know, that had to hurt. So he asked the translator to do like, you know, give me a sword, you know, and the translator throws in his leg. You know, like the translator got him in his trouble in the first place.
Yeah.
And then basically, what, cut two arteries in his leg? You know,
I mean, yeah.
And then, leaving to add insult to injury, they shoot another dart at him.
I know. I love that. I have cat-like reflexes. And he's just screaming.
You know, not only does he not have cat-like reflexes because he didn't move.
Yeah.
He's got like a dead cat reflex because literally the spear came and he didn't move until it actually hit him.
Yeah.
I don't know what kind of reflexes he's talking about.
So here's something that's really funny. It's not like... Obviously, we have a lot of these interviews and we choose these movies, but sometimes we don't think about the parallels, like Anaconda 3, our last movie. In that film, we made fun of the henchmen because they were all dirty and gross looking. How about in this movie? Well, what is that, like a stipulation to be a henchman? Okay, you got to not bathe regularly. These guys are so dirty and nasty when Ace comes up on them and they have the bat in the cage and they're just sitting there talking to each other. And it's just like, God, these guys are so freaking gross, but I guess this is what you got to do.
I think when you're a henchman in the jungle, you know, I think it's a little different. Like, you know, listen, you pitch your henchmen for like the mafia or something. You know, they're all dressed in suits. They dress, you know, they're in America. When you're in the Amazon jungle, I mean, you know, you got to look dirty to be a henchman.
Yeah.
I mean, at Anaconda, they were dirty and they were in the jungle or New Jersey. We still haven't, you know, figured that one out.
Yeah, it's true. Yeah.
You know, so here, you know, the same difference. You know, you had a... You know, yeah. I think you got to be dirty, you got to be sweaty, and you got to really have no common sense.
Yeah, and then Ace, he does his amazing calls that he does to the silverbacked gorilla, the gorillas. You know, then those guys are like, oh, that's a lot of money. It's mating season. So then Ace, you think he's going to get the bat? No, he gets knocked out. That's what we mentioned before, when he gets tied to the raft, and the monkey's tied to the raft, and they're floating down to a waterfall for their death.
I think that's a scene from a movie, and I don't know which which movie it was. It might have been a movie called The Mission, maybe, with Rob De Niro or something. Because I remember seeing that like on a box cover or something. So I think that's another scene from the movie. Yeah.
So that's what they did. Steve Odenkirk, when he wrote this movie, he watched like a bunch of movies and wrote the script and just took a little piece of it. We'll spoof that. Oh, yeah, I'll spoof that.
And it worked. And it, you know, it works. If you know the movie, it works. And if you don't know the movie, it's a funny scene. So, you know, either way, it's a win-win.
Especially if the monkey leaves him and he's screaming. His screaming, Jim Carrey, his screaming as Ace is the best.
Well, you know, not for nothing. I mean, the Ace let the monkey loose. He helped him untie the one arm. And then the monkey was supposed to help Ace and he leaves him. Like he totally screwed him. And then how high was that waterfall that he went down?
I know. So Ace needs to figure out what happened. So he goes to the room, like the sacred room where the bat is.
Before you even get there.
Yeah.
Don't forget about the fight he had with the alligator.
Oh, yeah. The movie cover. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, so he, you know, he falls down, you know, the waterfall. You don't see him. And then he pops out of the water like he just survived. And he was, you know, like he just couldn't believe it. He's like, I survived. He's like out of breath. And then he turns his head quickly and there's an alligator staring right in his eyes.
Another line, everyone who's seen this movie, I know it might be in other things or other references, but quit hitting yourself, quit hitting yourself. And he's using the like rubber alligator's arms to punch himself. He's has it in a headlock, giving it noogies.
Well, isn't it kind of like Adam Sandler in Happy Gilmore?
Oh, yeah.
Adam Sandler, he gives him the elbow, like, you know, it's a whole.
Oh, yeah, dude. Is it the same exact scene?
It's similar, you know, because he had his ball. He had his golf ball. So it was a similar kind of scene because.
So Sandler did an Odenkirk because his movie Happy Gilmore came out 4 months later.
Oh, same year?
Different year.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, this came out in 96, February. Happy Gilmore, February 16th, 96. Ace came out November 10th, 95.
Oh, wow. Okay. So, yeah. So that's, what are the odds of two movies having an alligator wrestling match? I mean, like, you know.
It started a big trend in movies. Alligator fights were so huge.
Well, you want to go take it even further back. You have Crocodile Dundee.
Does he fight an alligator like that? Does he elbow drop?
I don't think so. He might have wrestled one. I think, you know, he is Crocodile Dundee. So I don't think he just kills him. I'm sure he wrestled him, but I don't know. Dude, something.
I would hope he fights a crocodile. I haven't seen that movie in a while, but I would hope he does.
I'm sure he does.
The name of the movie.
Yeah, that's true.
So I love when he's meditating with the monks because he wants to go see the monk and the monkey's with him. The monkey can meditate, comes with him. And again, it's screaming, talking about where's the medallion, Ace? I lost it, okay? It's probably in a big pile of guano. So did you ever figure out why guano is so important? Because of the pottery?
Well, because it's used for everything. So there's a market for it. So I think that because he talks about it later on.
No, I know, but.
Yeah, so it's used for making the pottery, for eating it. They were eating guano paste and like, you know, so it's.
Were eating guano paste. They were eating off of guano.
He was eating the paste. Remember, he was eating that paste in the when he meets the princess.
Yeah, but he was grossed out because the bowl was shit. I don't think he was eating shit.
No, that's why he spit it out. He goes, this fruit paste is good. He goes, what is it made of? It was guano.
No, he said, what is this? This is pottery. What is this pottery made out of? No, why would you eat shit out of a shit bowl? That sounds weird.
You're not in that tribe. You don't know. That's what they eat. They eat grubs. They eat other kind of things. I'm almost positive. I thought he was eating the guano paste.
No.
Have you ever tried guano paste?
No.
So how do you know it's not good?
I don't know. But if he ate shit, I can understand him being like, oh, yeah, this is gross.
What's honey?
Bee shit.
Okay. So how do you know guano, you know, it doesn't taste good?
I guess I have to try it. If there's any guano experts, please contact us.
Please.
So we talked about this a little bit earlier about, oh yeah. So, the references, Charlton Heston, this is when Ace parks the car and he flips over and then he says, what are you doing? HR shoving stuff. So there's just all these old references over and over again, but Ace uses an animal to help him out. An elephant saves the day.
Yeah.
He says, sit, Bobo, and it sits on the guy.
Yeah. Well, and he also, you know, it's funny. So here's another reference, and you probably, I don't know if you've ever seen the movie. So he also later on, he arrives on an ostrich, right? Yeah. Riding an ostrich. There's a movie with Bill Cosby called Leonard Part 6.
Who never saw it?
Okay. It's horrendous. And Bill Cosby rides an ostrich in that movie.
That's awesome.
So I don't know if they use that, but because I think seeing a human on an ostrich is pretty funny.
Oh, yeah.
So I think
it's good. It remind me of Jumanji, but it kind of looked pretty cool because the way they did it was different than Jumanji because it looked pretty real. Obviously, all those animals can't be in the same room, but Ace talked to all of them. He says, animals, lend me your rears. And he starts talking out of his ass. Then all the animals go in, start beating everybody up. And a Scarface reference for the kids.
Yep.
Say hello to my stinky little friend.
And you know, you see that Scarface reference in a lot of movies.
Oh yeah.
But this one is well done. Because like, you know, there's just the way it was. I think that was a perfect choice to do for that scene.
Well, he's almost gonna get shot. And Greenwald saves the day by knocking the guy on the ground.
Well, I love the scene even before the animals show up there when he realizes he's in trouble and he says, hit the lights. And yeah, he's like Greenwald. He's rolling around for a good, like, you know, maybe a minute and like no one's moving.
And then, so then Canby, he's leaving. He's getting away in his car. Ace, I love when he looks in the cars for keys. Not keys in car one, no keys in car two, but then there's keys in cars three, and that's a monster truck. So when he gets in that and starts driving, I would have to confirm it, but I'm sure that's probably Cannibal Corpse playing in the background, just with no lyrics.
I think it is.
Because that's his favorite band.
Yeah, no, sure. I think it is. Yeah. I actually, you know, it's funny. I actually have the soundtrack somewhere.
Of this?
Yeah. Oh,
holy
yeah.
Holy crap.
I had the soundtrack to this one and the first one, because I think the Blues Travelers might have sang Secret Agent Man. It wasn't the original song.
Cool.
I'm almost positive, but I think it is.
Cannibal. Oh, it's definitely not the original one. I was hoping it was the Bruce Willis version.
No. I think it might be Blues Travelers, but I think it is Cannibal Corpse. Yeah. So, you go. So he's now, I never really seen a monster truck. Do they lift up like that?
So, I think some of them do, but just for that to be there, it was just perfect timing that he needed one just to rip through the jungle. Yeah. The other guy's driving like kind of a normal looking car.
Yeah. And I love how he's like talking to him, like pretending like he just saw him on the road. Hey, what are you doing here?
Cabby from the consulate?
Weird, huh?
And then if you were wondering, is there going to be any animals raping humans in this movie? Yeah, about 85 minutes in, it happens. The silverback gorillas that are in heat have sex with Canby.
Foreshadowing of the rustling of the bushes early in the movie.
As soon as you saw that, you knew it had to happen. Would it be gorilla on gorilla? No, it's gorilla on man. So the war is about to happen. Ace, he has the bat. He's running through. Everybody stops. He yells Shikaka. Everybody gets on their knees. Saves the day.
Well, he had to make a choice. So he had to make a choice. Does he go after the bad guy or does he save the tribes and bring the bat, which he doesn't want to touch? So he chooses to save the tribes. And the way he's running with this bat in his hands, I'm telling you, I would have done the same thing. If I had to carry a bat that looked like that, I'd be running with it like just like that. And the way he was doing it was perfect.
Yeah, you know? we had a bat in our house. And the way I got it out, it was kind of like that.
What, the house?
And hold it. Yeah.
And you had a bat in your house.
Yeah, I've there's probably one in the attic right now.
Oh. So how'd you get it out?
And you were in this house. It somehow got into the bathroom and it was on the bathroom window. So I used a diaper box, put it on the outside, and then wrapped something around it. And then when I put him outside, he was just laying there.
And you had no problem doing it?
I had to. I have to do it for my family.
But you had no problem? Were you icky inside or you're like, this is no big deal?
No big deal. I'm Batman.
Oh, nice.
So the end of the movie is the coolest because they're having the wedding and they don't even show, they just show Ace talking to Greenwald and they're like, she's not pure, right? That's all it was?
Well, no. So Tommy Davidson comes out screaming.
Oh yeah, they're in a hut because they're about in a hut. Well,
they had the wedding ceremony, and then they walk in. And Tommy Davis is all excited. They walk into the hut, and then like just a couple seconds later, I mean that was pretty quick. There was no getting into it. A couple seconds later, he walks, screams, running out that she's not pure, and that's when Ace is like, "Oop."
Yeah, they can tell that, and then he runs away. So the one thing I was thinking, obviously it doesn't mean that he had to get her pregnant, but I was thinking like, oh, Ace Jr. should have been a Milano, a half black,
so,
half white.
So you're saying Josh Flitter, who played Ace Jr., his mom's a princess in the Wachuchi tribe?
Or he has a long lost brother.
Ah, interesting.
And he was with Cusack's sister after this. And then, but no, this movie's awesome. Honestly, like we always talk about, would you recommend this? Of course. Is there anything you would have changed?
You know what? I don't think so. I think, you know, I think it's made the way they upped the ante from the first movie.
Oh yeah.
It starred Jim Carrey in every scene, which really, that's all I wanted to see. Like, you know, like I don't care about the other, you know, characters. Like, and I think I think they did a great job as a follow. Like I said, this is one of the few sequels that I could say is better than the first one, and they're great. So no, I wouldn't change anything, I don't think.
Yeah, I think it's perfect because usually it takes to like the third or fourth movie to do something completely different. You know, they could have done another one, search and helping out some other thing in the States. So it's cool that he went to Africa and did this. So
I would say the only thing I would change maybe, and I think I kind of touched on this before, is maybe lessen some of the repetitive jokes and bring some new things in there. You know, like instead of saying alrighty, then have something else, or instead of saying loser again, have something else that is kind of the same, but like different.
Yeah.
But you know what? Again, they kind of amped it up a little bit when he was saying those. So it works. I mean, it's, you know, it was such a great movie.
Yeah, no, that's it. So that is Ace Ventura When Nature Calls. The next movie that we're going to be covering is probably one of the silliest like family movies that it's probably our first family movie, Super Babies, Baby Geniuses 2. And the interview that we have for that is awesome. Jamie got us in contact with Vanessa Angel. You know her from Kingpin, Weird Science, the TV show. And she stars in Super Babies, which also has John Voight, which is very interesting. So, yeah, so that's going to be the new movie. Don't forget to review, rate, share our podcast. Follow us on all social media at Sequels Only. Check out our new website, sequelsonly.com. Good night.
Good night.
Take care now. Bye-bye then.